it's good for us to know about Martin Luther King and of a person like Jesse Jackson mm-hmm. or men like that, Al Sharpton. I don't think it's invalid for us to know about that, to understand that and how that functions. And even with King and the other men as well, you know, there's sort of a theological liberalism. There's sort of a moderate aspect to their actual theology. And that's sort of what people think about. They think about the Reverend Al Sharpton, this guy, that guy. But first of all, there's a much broader, deeper, I would even say more faithful heritage there, first of all. And second of all, you know, we need to expand this out and to really say, what else is there? Because there's some really rich resources from which everyone can learn from. For example, let's say you're not a black Christian. Let's say you're not even an American Christian. You're a Christian in some other part of the world. These guys are wonderful to know about because they show how in the midst of oppression, in the midst of sort of poverty surroundings, in the midst of all that kind of struggle and injustice, how men can still be faithful men of God, focusing on the life-changing power of the gospel for local bodies. So it's important to kind of give us a model, a sketch of what that looks like. And so there's a lot here, and that's why we think the show is important to do. Ramon, you about to read something?
Oh, no, I mean, I was just sort of prepping for some of the guys that we'll be talking about.
Vermo, what is the dates of history on that book, The Decline of African-American Theology? What range are we talking about?
Well, we're looking at, pre-Revolutionary War era. As early back as the 1600.
Okay.
All the way to, modern day.
And so I've read The Faithful Preacher. I haven't read The Decline of African-American Theology. Is that book say that there was more in the past? There is a more robust tradition, mm-hmm. and what's up with that now? I mean, what's the sort of thesis?
Yeah, that's exactly right. I mean, we don't have nearly enough time to go through all the different names of people out there, but it's really remarkable what the Beatty's done is really trace back and look at what people actually said back in the 1600s, 1700s, and all the way through until really probably the 20th century when it began to turn. And how deeply biblical it was. I was reading earlier today just how much they press people, ministers, to be educated, to not sort of just hoop and holler and say all sorts of different, things just for the entertainment of people, but to be rooted in the scriptures, high view of the sovereignty of God and human responsibility. One of the guys we'll be talking about, Lemuel Haynes, really had a compatibilistic view. God is sovereign over all things, and men are responsible for their decisions. Both are true. I mean, you read it, and you're like, it's amazing, really. And you're seeing this being very much, this is part of our history. It's part of African-American history.
Yeah, so let's talk a little about the first guy, Lemuel Haynes. The way to be labels him as sort of pastoral ministry in light of eternity. And I think that's an apt description from the sermons I've been able to read. And it's funny, there's a what is that book? I think it's one of the sort of academic books that Tabidi drew from. It's called, Black Calvinist, Black Republican? Or what's the name of that book that he drew from a lot for his research? Did you see that in the bibliography notes?
Oh, no, I didn't see that. That's interesting.
But I mean, there was no Republican Party back then. It made it in a sort of a different way.
Yeah, yeah.
But here's what's interesting. Right in the beginning, you get into this guy's life. Let me just read a little bit. Following his indenture, Haynes volunteered in 1774 as a Minuteman, and in October 1776 joined the Continental Army, thus becoming part of the American Revolution. And this is a patriot.
Yeah.
This is someone right there. So he is around when the American War for Independence is happening,
mm-hmm.
and that's the context he's functioning in. Now he gets sick later on, and so he's out of the army, but eventually, as he begins to study more and more, finds himself, goes towards the pastoral pulpit. And here's what's so fantastic, is that look at the people that influenced him, brought out in this book, Jonathan Edwards, George Whitefield, and Philip Doddridge. Those are the people who influenced Haynes the most, thoroughly reformed in his theology. So, guys, Lecrae and Triple E and Ambassador and the Cross Movement and Reach Records and Lamp Mode and Humble Beast, they're not the first black Calvinists to have ever existed. It's been going on for a while.
Yeah,
and that's what we're trying to recover.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at what Haynes would write about, I mean, he believed firmly in election, predestination, total depravity of man, the need to preach the gospel. I mean, it's just and to call people to salvation. I mean, all these things, and you know, the need for conversion, for new birth.
Yeah,
and what makes him interesting is you know, he pastored for several decades in all white congregations.
Yeah,
which is, I mean, talk about incredibly unusual. Now, unfortunately, you know, his ministry ended because I think eventually sort of racial prejudice got in the way and they discharged him from his duties. But the fact that he was in the mix like
it was like 30 some years, yeah, wasn't it?
I mean, that's just, you can imagine how that stood out back in that time period.
It's rare for now.
Yeah, you're right.
I mean, how many, you know, black pastors over a mainly white congregation, especially for 30 years.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not just rare for then, but try to just put it in this context. Let me read something else about Haynes just to look at his accomplishments, how the Lord used him. Haynes began his formal ministerial training by studying Greek and Latin with two Connecticut clergymen, Daniel Ferron and William Bradford. He was licensed to preach on November 29th, 1780, and 5 years later became the first African-American ordained by any religious body in America. In 1804, Middlebury College awarded Haynes an honorary master's degree, another first for an African-American. When we come back, we'll finish up with Haynes, as well as get into some of the other men laid out in Beattie's book, The Faithful Preacher, talking about black Christians you should probably know, but probably don't. Don't worry, we'll help you.
Part of the reason why we're doing this show, I think more attention should be brought to them. You know, this is sort of an interesting side note. I mean, it is interesting sort of the people who get attention in history and the people who don't, sort of the effects of that. And some cases, it's just good marketing. You know, there's an argument to be made that Friedrich Nietzsche would not have been known at all if it wasn't for, you know, his family members who sort of promoted his writings. So,
right.
So that being said, I would say, to some degree, yeah, I mean, they're speaking more to – they probably had more influence really within black church circles. And so, I mean, they're talking about guys like Richard Allen or Payne especially. I mean, you know, from what we can tell, Daniel Payne, a bishop in AME Church, Thabiti puts it, basically, I mean, he almost single-handedly changed the whole educational culture of the AME Church, bringing into – basically helping people see – that ministers should be educated,
yeah,
and in fact must be educated, along with character as well. And so, huge influence in a denomination that you know, one of the five prominent black denominations in this country. So, certainly influence there. I mean, I'd say more broadly speaking, you're talking about guys like Frederick Douglass, Phyllis Wheatley, who's one of the first African American poets,
Probably
had broader influence. And again, this just shows you it sort of just depends on how because you know it was a white majority culture that sort of controlled everything, right? You know, Phyllis Wheatley became prominent because her sort of white patrons, I think her slaveholders really, promoted her poetry everywhere. So that's why I think she really had much more influence, you might say. And she had solid theology as well.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we're not, like I mentioned some folks in the beginning, but when you talk about Frederick Douglass, when you talk about Phyllis Wheatley, when you talk about Sojourner Truth, you're talking about some real legit people that also need some more attention,
mm-hmm,
not just like, you know, tokenism, but actually what they said.
Yeah,
like, and that's really what this is about. What we're saying is what they're saying is important and meaningful. Why do we study anybody? Why do we study Augustine, by the way, who was from North Africa himself? Why do we study Origen? Why do we study, you know, why do we care? What we're saying is they had an impact and an influence in a society a lot of times when it was not always easy, and what they're saying is relevant for us today. It's a way that we see men and women living out the gospel. And so that's what this is about. Now, before you continue on, let me mention, you know, there is a little quote from one of Haynes' early biographers in the late 1700s, Pastor Bob. And the biographer says that Calvinism was more of a default position in this observer's mind of sort of the black community in America. And he talks about it in this quote in the book, The Faithful Preacher. And this is what he says at the end. Not until around 1815 would African-American authors such as John Jay explicitly declare themselves against Calvinism and for, quote, free will religion.
Mm-hmm.
So he's saying that was more embedded in part of what was there, which makes sense as you think about it because there was a lot of Puritans, mm-hmm, and Reformed Christians in America at the time as well.
Yeah.
So I guess that makes sense.
Yeah.
So he's saying that was the beginning of a turn. Is this true? Because I'm really asking. Is Thabiti's thesis that the foundations of African American theology was reformed and sound, and then around 1815, there was a beginning of a slow decline, or what is the what are you saying, Vermont? What is the thesis?
Well, you know, it's interesting. I mean, he would say, I mean, in some ways it tracks along with you know, mainline denominations. I mean, you might say that's when alternate views began to began to creep up, I would say, in terms of maybe there was dominant, more reformed understanding of a number of different things. And then, yeah, around that time, and then, but, you know, from what I can tell, I mean, I would say, I mean, and I want to make sure I'm accurately characterizing what Thabiti is saying. It does seem probably that the biggest shifts happen around the turn of the turn of the 20th century. So, 1900 and on, with the rise of Pentecostalism. And then, sort of the Black Power movement sort of coincided with Black theology, which emphasized this idea of sort of the priority of the oppressed over the oppressor.
Yeah, that's where you get the phrases like "God is black,"
yeah.
And that has a certain meaning to the authors.
Exactly right.
Yeah.
So that's where the Grimke comes in. We'll get to him, I know, but I mean, he's right around the turn of the century.
He's like some of his last stuff is like in the 30s, I think, isn't it?
Yeah, 36. But the 1892 was one of his first ones. So he was pretty prominent for about 40 years, I think.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, I mean, that's when you sort of see, and that's when, you know, the shifts. I mean, similar with like anything else, you see the shifts happen in the Princeton, Princeton and other some of those seminaries, and then sort of trailing behind was some of the same shifts in the Black denominations. I mean, it does seem to me sort of the rise of Pentecostalism was a big, probably, watershed moment. I mean, you
so
have
early
people.
1900s, you know, talk about the revival.
And so were African-Americans a part of that rise of Pentecost? Were they a huge part of it?
Most certainly. So Azusa Street, which is in L.A., abandoned, like, warehouse they had rented out, the guy sort of leading that was a Black pastor, who had learned from sort of the beginning kind of Pentecostal guys, and it's reported that these kind of revivals were happening there. And for a while, the early Pentecostal movement was really actually ethnically unified. There were sort of Black and white worshiping together because it was under the guise of this sort of new Pentecostalism that had been happening, and eventually it became more and more segregated out, unfortunately, and there were some negative things that happened. But most certainly, I mean, because I think it had to do with, look, hey, the Spirit's fallen. We don't care if you're Black, white, male, female, but eventually culture sort of overtook even that.
Yeah, I think that's where you begin to see it be untethered, almost a mysticism that's untethered from Scripture. I mean, if you were to trace, I mean, I forgot one probably important thing to mention is a rise of Methodism, you know, during particularly in the Second Great Awakening, this is in the 1800s. I mean, and there's African Americans that tracked along with that. And so, you know, I might say that was a shift away from a more reformed understanding. However, the Methodists still were concerned to preach the gospel, you know, preach the scriptures, those type of things. I think a sort of when it began to be untethered, I'd say, from, you know, expositional preaching. And,
Is there a reason why the Methodist Church was particularly effective with Black Christians?
I wonder if it's, I'm guessing here, but it seems to me as if their method was really effective. I mean, they were really aggressive in spreading and evangelism. The idea of personal holiness and sanctification, I think, was appealing.
Well, man, guys, I still actually got a Haynes quote I got to read when we get back to the other side of the break. So we're taking a long time on Haynes, but eventually we'll get to the other guys here on Black Christians You Should Know But Probably Don't.
And Vocab, you had a quote you wanted to read?
Yeah, about Lemuel Haynes, the guy in the beginning of The Faithful Preacher. And it says this: during his stay in Rutland, the church grew in membership from 42 congregants to about 350 as Haynes modeled pastoral devotedness and fidelity to the people in his charge. He also emerged as a defender of Calvinistic orthodoxy, opposing the encroachment of Arminianism, Universalism, and other errors. And when I first searched him on the internet, the first sermon that kept on popping up under Haynes was a sermon that was against a prominent Universalist guy in his day and era. So, which is sort of a liberal idea, of course, in its core. And he did all this not just in the midst of bigotry and prejudice, but also this. Listen to this. A lot of kids. In 1783, Haynes met and married 20-year-old Elizabeth Babbitt, a young white schoolteacher and a member of the Middle Granville congregation. The couple bore 10 children between 1785 and 1805. So this dude just gets props. And you know what's so cool is one of his last sermons, I think, is in that book. And even though he had kind of got kicked out, probably there was the bigotry that kind of crept up, and also people under church discipline didn't like what was going on, is my understanding. But his last sermon is not, it doesn't have animus or bitterness. It's just a faithful preacher
right.
saying, here's what the Lord has done. And
in fact, that was his last sentence. Yeah. Something to do about hoping that he was faithful. So that's that's pretty impressive.
So,
well, yeah, I would dare say that if you put if you did a lot of discipline today, you'd probably get run out, black or white.
Yeah, no doubt. Well, let's transition to our next guy. Who is it, Vermone? What do you want to say about him?
Bishop Daniel A. Payne. Thibidi describes him as a vision for an educated pastorate. And that's really cool. I mean, it's really clear in the chapter. I mean, this is one of my favorite chapters in the book because it's something I really believe in as well. Just the importance of education in general, but you know his particular passion, education of African Americans, men and women, which really makes him stand out and sort of just the push he did for that, you know, and he had hurdles to face, you know, in the chapter in this book, The Faithful Preacher, just mentioned how in 1835 South Carolina passed a law basically forbidding the education of slaves of people of color, and that. Yeah, and so Daniel Payne was really, I mean, faced a huge hurdle kind of early on in his desire to do this. So he moved to New York and sort of resumed his quest to make this happen, joined the African Methodist Episcopal Church. And it was there that he, as I said in an earlier segment, he really changed the whole culture. And I love this quote from him. It says, here was the state of the church in the AME church you know, when he got started. Up to this time, any ignoramus who imagined that he was called to preach, who thought that the Lord had need of him, felt that it was his right to be ordained or at least to be licensed, and no objection was interposed by the church, under the impression that if a man opened his mouth, the Lord would fill it. And so after his reforms in the church, this was the change. The church was now firmly committed to the policy of intelligence as against ignorance in the pulpit. Its aim henceforth would be not only to see that the gospel was preached, but that was done by men who had at least some intellectual preparation for it. I love it. I love it.
These guys didn't play around.
And that's a certain view of the importance of education, the work of the Holy Spirit using our mind.
Yeah.
Pastoral
training.
Well, we still have a battle with that today, don't we?
Well, we do. Yeah. That's why, you know.
That's why these guys are still important, too.
Well, I mean, I think, you know, this is why it's a worthwhile book to go through, because you read it and you're like, wow, that preaches today, because sure. There is still this sense of, well, God called me, and that's it, you know. And usually that calling is based on sort of charisma, you know, sort of vocal ability or, you know, whatever that might be. And you begin to see the effect on the church when someone is called, quote unquote, called to the ministry and begins pastoral ministry down the road, when clearly they have no way of handling the text. And they get pretty much taken in any way direction because they have no ability to really study.
So why is it we can't have a balance? I mean, is it true that it's the more Pentecostal or charismatic movements, denominations that have a lower view of formal education? And if so, if that's true, I think it is, why is it that we can't get this balance between education and prayer, between study and the importance of the Holy Spirit? Why do we still struggle with that for now 2,000 years?
What would you say? Okay. I mean, would you say that? I don't think Pentecostalism used to be that way.
Well, I mean, I don't know, but I know going back to 1 Corinthians, those guys had the same problem. Yeah. They didn't want to hear the cross and some boring, shaky guy.
No, you're right.
They wanted to hear somebody entertain them with fancy words, and Paul was like, I ain't having that. Here's what's up.
Yeah.
And Paul himself, of course, was an educated person.
Yeah.
You know, so, I mean, I don't know, but that's just a struggle the humans want. They want some entertainment, not some Jesus. All right, when we get back, we'll finish up this guy on Backpack Radio. Black Christians you should know, but probably don't. Until now.
Black Christians that you probably don't know, but should, and probably don't know, because most of us don't know much about black history at all in theological circles, certainly not in the Reformed camp. So, Vermone...
Not even in hip-hop. I can't tell you how many songs I've heard that have said, this is not a lie, this is not exaggeration. I've heard at least two I can think of off the top of my head that said Harriet Tubman stood up because she refused to go to the back of the bus.
Oh my goodness!
And another one that referred to Rosa Parks's involvement with the Underground Railroad. Two different rap songs I specifically know, and the funny thing is they're both my friends, and I asked them about it. Like, yeah, I didn't realize till afterwards, and I'm just saying they're both black dudes. So
oh my goodness!
was like, man, actually,
let's, you can't tell me stuff like that.
Let's go watch Roots together, man. We need to go watch Roots together because this ain't working, man.
Oh, man.
Blame it on the system. Okay, but we're talking about Daniel Payne, and this is so amazing. So he's 19, a carpenter, opens up a school in 1829 with three children and three adult slaves for a monthly income of $3. And he closed the school because of lack of money, later reopened it, and it actually started doing really well there in the South. From 1830 to 1835, they had 60 pupils, which is, this is just amazing. And they were teaching all kinds of stuff, botany, chemistry, geography, philosophy, astronomy, French, all of this, and it was part of the instruction. But that law you mentioned earlier, an act to amend the law relating to slaves and free persons of color, which basically said, don't be teaching black folks, of course, made the school have to be shut down. So then the book continues and says he's sleepless, loaded with disappointment, failing in prayer, and doubting the existence and justice of God. He had to close the school, and then he moves to New York, and then he actually goes for further education at Lutheran Theological Seminary in Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, and gets some education there, and is ordained fully as a Lutheran at the age of 26 years old. What's he do next, V?
Well, you know, from there he becomes part of the AME Church, becomes a bishop, and you know, as I said before, you know, he begins to lead to all these different educational reforms, and you know, in the providence and the grace of God, he was able to start a new school, the Wilberforce University, for the grand work of Christian education, and served for 13 years as its first president. And what's great about this university, it was committed to educating men and women for Christian work and ministry and community at home. I mean, he meant that broadly. I mean, and think about this too. I mean, just first of all, just a school that was passionate about educating African-Americans, but not just African-American men, but also African-American women. Really remarkable.
Yeah, and you know, I'm reading some of the excerpts as we're going through this from one of his sermons. Here's one called "Who is Sufficient for These Things?" And in this, listen, this is a reading from the book. It says that first the preacher is to preach the gospel. That's what he says, first of all, which, again, still very relevant today, black and white. And he says the vocation did not consist of, quote, loud declamation and vociferous talking, end quote, or whooping, stamping, and beating the Bible in the desk, end quote, or seeing who, quote, halloos the loudest and speaks the longest, end quote. And he says, look, your first job is to preach the gospel. And again, this is still so relevant. I mean, you turn on TV, you know, you go to a local church, and it's good to see.
You see this broadly, too.
It's not just a black problem, is it?
No.
Obviously, it's not. I mean, there's plenty of issues, and we mentioned some of the issues within Pentecostalism, but I mean, you go on TV, and I mean, that's mainstream in a sense, it's on TV. But, I mean, you see these guys, they knew what was important, even in the midst of all the stuff they had to deal with. That's what's amazing. It's sort of easier for us, at least in my mind, to sort of be focused because we don't have the extra stuff of, like, the bigotry and the stuff. It's easy to get off on the tangent of just the man problems.
Mm-hmm.
He talks about that, but he's still really centered on the gospel. At least that's my reading of Payne. Yeah. So mm-hmm. I appreciate that.
Yep.
You want to say anything else about Payne?
Well, probably more I could say, but I want to make sure we leave enough time for Francis Grimke.
Right. Well, let me mention this. And, Vermont, I don't know if you want to say anything about this. I'm not the expert of how some of the so-called, I don't know what I mean by so-called, but the denominations that are labeled as historically black. You know, people see, they see, oh, AME African, what's this, what's that? You know, the reason why this had to happen is because a lot of Christians who were white in those days, they weren't going to let the black folks be around. There was a time in some of these congregations where they could at least, I'm not saying this is good, but sit up on the balcony or in the back or something like that. But things got worse in certain ways before they got better. And you had horrible situations where people were praying in the front, you know, really coming to the Lord. Repentance in sort of a mixed congregation, and white deacons would come and forcibly remove them as mm-hmm. they're in the middle of repenting. And that's how I think one of the denominations came into existence, if I'm not mistaken, a story that's similar to that. And so
that's what happened with Richard Allen.
Yeah, okay, yeah, so it was Richard Allen.
Yeah, really, yeah. Richard Allen, I mean, he was, you know, was a minister preaching to blacks and whites, and then basically I kicked out of the denomination. And that's
for being black.
For being black, yeah.
And black so, while preaching.
So Vermont,
that's what helped him start. That's why he ended up starting the first. Yes. That was the first African American denomination.
Yeah.
And so I mean, it's one of those things you just can imagine how might the history of
been different
for Christendom in general, maybe this country, if you know there had been some way to stop sort of people from racial prejudice against black. I mean, almost a natural impulse was, of course, we do church together.
Yeah.
What year was that?
Culture overtook.
Richard Allen. What year was that?
Probably late 18th century.
I think you're right.
So you had mentioned earlier in the show there were five historical African-American denominations. Is that right? Are they still around today?
Mm-hmm. You visited one of the old. And didn't you go to New York?
Do you know offhand what the five are?
I know some of them. I can pull it up real quick here.
Well, could you just, like, what about the one you went to in New York? Which one was?
It's called People's Church.
And that's like a really historically prestigious, well-known.
Yeah. I mean, it goes back to, Revolutionary War. It's merged with a couple other churches over time. But, a long history of that church.
I think
it's the first, if I'm remembering correctly, it's the first African-American church in, I think, in a colonial, sort of colonial era, one of the first, at least.
Is that part of a denomination or just a well-known independent church?
I can't remember offhand.
I don't know their polity. But, the sad thing is, imagine the kind of what-if scenario. What if the folks in charge and power would have listened to James and wouldn't have done the whole, the Christians of James' book were at least better. They would say, well, you sit on the floor. Hey, rich guy, you get here. At least they let him sit in the church. They would say, you sit over here on the floor. Hey, poor guy, you sit at my feet. But at least the guy wasn't kicked out of the church. Here, it's even worse, in all seriousness of, you can't be here. You can't worship with us. You go worship over there. And we don't want you to learn how to read because we're more worried about our financial issues than we are you knowing the Bible. So we're going to make laws again. I mean, how things could have been different. But they're not. But let's talk about that and let's be part of fixing it now here in the 21st century. So we probably need to move to Grimke, don't we, V?
Yes, we do. I was trying to look up something
Bob Session. You're his Google.
That's right.
Francis J. Grimke, The Gospel and the Church in the World. He's the most modern of the three.
Yeah, I mean, his story is I mean, again, all these stories are really amazing. 1850 to 1937, for 5 decades, pastor of the 15th Street Presbyterian Church in Washington, D.C. He's a former slave and also a nephew to some famous abolitionists. End up studying at Lincoln and Howard University and got his theological education at Princeton. Good to see.
Who did he hang out with?
Charles Hodge.
Charles Hodge, what?
Yeah, which is really cool.
Just another sad note on history. I had a friend go to the 200th anniversary of Princeton Seminary, and there wasn't anything there. They didn't do anything. And he said that they're embarrassed by the likes of Charles Hodge today.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure they are.
Man.
they should just talk about Grimke, and maybe they could talk about him instead then.
But that's what I said.
But yeah, I mean, so that's where he was, and I mean, he spent six decades of Christian ministry there. I mean, this is just again, that this book is aptly titled, The Faithful Preacher. These guys are serious about impacting their communities with the gospel. And we need more men like this in the church in America today, whatever their color may be,
Amen. So, what I like about Grimke is, there's a number of different things you can point out. Another guy who's committed to biblical orthodoxy, but also, a guy who spoke to social issues.
Yes, he did.
So, and I think it's important, and I think in the right way. So there's right ways to do it. There's wrong ways to do it.
Yeah.
And sadly, I would say some of the ways that it's been done today aren't as rooted in the scriptures as Grimke was. And one of the things he would do, just would speak really, really strongly about the racial inequality and prejudice. He, called for white Christians to basically either renounce Christianity or basically had the integrity.
Yeah, be a Christian. That's
exactly
what he's telling them
to do. He said Christianity should compel you to embrace your black brothers and sisters. He said every principle of Christianity, every sentiment of true religion is totally, absolutely opposed to racial prejudice in every shape and form.
Amen. And these guys... I don't know if – I don't like this phrase, but I don't know how else to say it. They had, in a sense, the moral high ground. And what I mean is, imagine how easy it would have been to be bitter and hateful and be like, all right, you don't want to hang out with me? I'll do my own church and I don't care anyway. Let's keep it separate. Let's do this. I'm tired of getting hurt and pushed around. I'm done with y'all.
Yep.
But they were constantly – preaching and living out the gospel, you know, in a way that just, it's amazing to see the forgiveness that they're living in their life and the really the constant love. I mean, to be able to say that, and these other guys, the way they interacted, you see, you know, what kind of character did this take? And you know they were impacted by the gospel of Jesus Christ, by these words and deeds.
Go on.
Well, no, I had another quote, but go ahead.
Oh, yeah, you might have the same quote as I do.
I'm going to change the subject slightly. I'm Grimke, though.
Okay, well, there's a quote from Grimke that I think that's interesting about white churches and black churches.
No, go.
We'll let you go first.
And I think I'd be interested in what you guys think of this. I mean, it's interesting to see so early on a guy having this sort of insight and speaking to something I think that almost not enough people speak to. He says this: why should there be churches? And this is 1910, all right? He spoke about this. I mean, think about how divided our country was in then, and almost how divided and just naturally accepted. Of course, we're separate, right? And he says this: why should there be churches made up of white Christians and churches made up of colored Christians in the same community? And we're all speak the same language. Why should white Christians and colored Christians not feel perfectly at home with each other in the same religious gatherings? If they are all Christians, if they all believe in the fatherhood of God and the brotherhood of man and doing by others as they would be done by and loving each other as they love themselves in their oneness in Christ Jesus, and if the same Holy Spirit dwells alike in all their hearts.
Amen. I mean, what else can you say?
I mean, it's funny. It's just so the logic of it is impeccable. I mean, it just says, you know, and he says, look, if we're all speaking the same language, we're all in the same father, then why is it that we're creating sort of cultures where it's almost unacceptable, it's uncomfortable to worship together?
Yeah, I think some of these guys said, you know, and I'm paraphrasing perhaps some of the stuff I read from Grimke, but they were sort of constantly amazed at how much their fellow Christians, sort of the power holders in the society, were influenced more by cultural norms and practices and standards and prejudice and bigotry than they were by the gospel in regard to these issues. You know, they were like, come on, guys. You know, don't you see what I'm seeing here? Mm-hmm.
You know, he says, as Christianity is not clay in the hands of the world spirit to be molded by it, but is itself to be the molder of public sentiment and everything else. And so that's why, and that compelled him then to speak against racial prejudice and inequality and to speak strongly against it. You know, you can imagine just to stand out that way that put him out there, but he was willing to speak truth.
You know, it's disturbing, particularly within the Christian circles, to see that kind of racial prejudice.
Yeah.
However, you know, if you look back, if you think about it, the racial prejudice is such a huge problem worldwide that certainly is much bigger than the black-white prejudice. I know my own background, my grandmother from Eastern Europe was extremely prejudiced against her own, you know, people in the same country of a different
ethnic strand.
And there a lot of distrust and dislike
that
didn't get passed on because we weren't living there. So I don't know how that happens culturally, but it's a huge problem.
Well, you go back to Galatians 2, you see the Jew and the Gentile, you see those problems, but that's where I encourage people, as soon as this show ends, look up Ephesians chapter 2, read 11 through 22, and you'll see some amazing things there.